You make no friends in the pits and you take no prisoners. One minute you're up half a million in soybeans and the next boom.
Do not attempt to adjust your device.
The revolution starts now.
We have to pass the bill so that you can find out what is in it.
Turn those machines back on!
You are about to enter the halls of justice.
Show me the money!
If we lose freedom here, there's no place to escape to. This is the last stand on earth.
This is the Halls of Justice. Here are your hosts, Justice and Fat Man.
Oh, get down on it one time. Come on.
You did not say that. You did not just say that. Next thing you do is, next thing you're going to say is, hey, coming at you.
Yeah, we have stacks of wax for you tonight on the Halls of Justice. Nice to have you along. I'm Justice, along with the Fat Man. Good to see you again, Fat Man. 2 days in a row.
Hola, señor. Yo
did
quiero
you watch the big
Taco
speech?
Bell.
Did you get a chance? Because I know we did the show last night while the speech was on,
yeah.
Biden's speech. Did you DVR it? Were you that excited? Did you go back and watch it?
I honestly, I couldn't. I was able to watch the first 20 minutes. Live while I was waiting for you. I don't know if you were changing your own diaper or getting your Metamucil or whatever you were doing.
I was looking for my mask that was in my pocket.
Yeah. Well, that's right. You're recording outside, so you have to make sure when you're by yourself outside recording a podcast, you have to have 7 masks on. I think that's the latest. But I watched the first 20 minutes, and it was all just one-liners, and I'll tell you what, and I know how politics are, but politics is a dirty, dirty game, and this isn't something that Joe Biden invented or Donald Trump invented or Obama or, you know, Truman or Eisenhower. It goes back as far. Politics, it's just a dirty game. But to listen to the beginning of that propaganda speech last night, and all of these are to a certain degree, but the propaganda speech with him taking credit for what Donald Trump did, I can't believe that anybody believes this. As I'm sitting there watching it, he's talking about getting 200 million shots in people's arms in his first 100 days, how his original goal was 100 million, and he was able to get over 200 million. Well, why were you able to do that, Joe? Because of Operation Warp Speed. And then, of course, anytime you bring up Operation Warp Speed to a liberal,
oh, what do you mean? Trump was a scientist and he invented the
no. He is the person who was in charge and said, look, we're going to pull away these regulations and we're going to fast track everything. We're going to put millions and millions and maybe hundreds of millions of dollars out there in front of all of these drug companies. And we're going to say this, go get it. So you basically challenged the private sector. You took the chains off them and you put a big boatload of cash out there for these companies to go after, and they all went after it, and we got a vaccine, and we've got 3 of them now. So I don't know how President Biden, although he's been plagiarizing, you know, his whole entire career. I mean, remember, he's run for president before, and he had to back out because he got caught in major lies. Not campaign-type lies, but flat-out, like he said one time he graduated from a historically black college. And then I think it was Delaware State came out and said, not so much. And then he would plagiarize speeches. I mean, this is everybody, because he's an old man. Everybody talks about nice, honest, good guy, Uncle Joe. He's not. All a facade. He is not a good guy. But the point of it is he's going on about this speech, how he was able to put these shots in arms. And a few episodes ago, I talked at length and I laid on a bunch of statistics about if Biden just got out of the way, if he didn't do one thing with COVID, if he didn't do one thing with distribution of COVID, just get out of the way, Joe. Just go run and hide, kind of like Kakala is doing at the southern border, just running and hiding from the problem. If he just ran and hid from the problem of COVID, we were already on a pace to do over 200 million shots in his first 100 days. He didn't have to do anything. We were already there. It's like saying, I'm going to cook breakfast and I just got done eating breakfast that somebody else cooked for me. He's taking credit for something he did not do. And I could live with that to a certain degree if at least he would have come out and said, I didn't always agree with the previous administration. I didn't like the way the previous administration did a lot of things. But I think at this point where our country is with attacking this virus and trying to put it in the rearview mirror, we have to at least acknowledge the Trump administration and Operation Warp Speed and all of the sources of knowledge that those agencies that President Trump led, that the pharmaceutical companies, all of that coming together, and President Trump led it. And I just want to offer some congratulations and some appreciation for the job he did. I can disagree with him on 99% of the stuff he did, but I have to give him credit for that. That would have been the classy thing to do. But that won't play well in San Francisco. That won't play well in New York. And it won't play well with all these liberal whack jobs who can't even acknowledge that Trump was in the White House and was the person who led Operation Warp Speed. So that was the part of the speech that I was able to stomach, and I just couldn't take anymore. I'm like, if this is what he's going to be laying out for the next 20 or 30 minutes, because that's all he could last, I just don't need to hear anymore. He just, for the first 10 or 15 minutes of the speech, he stood there and literally patted himself on the back. But he's supposed to be nice Joe, the anti-Trump, the nice guy, the one, the modest Joe. Kiss my ass.
Ooh, he's angry tonight.
Remember the
big dissertation I gave about the socialism?
Yes.
So what I took away from the speech is, first off, they want to spend a lot of your money. And believe me, it's going to be your money. And I'll tell you why in a little bit. So they want to start with 2 years of preschool, free for everybody. Then you go to school. And then they want to do 2 years of college, community college, I think it is, after that. So literally from the cradle to 2 years past high school graduation, so I'm guessing to about the time you're 20, the government is going to have their hands on you. That's asking for free stuff. That's getting free stuff. It's depending on the government. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And where does it end? Is $6 trillion enough? How about $60 trillion? Then they're rolling out the printing presses. How about $600 trillion? So that rubs me the wrong way. Then Biden says he's calling for nearly doubling the capital gains tax rate in order to fund $1.8 trillion. Of the spending proposal. But when you dig deeper, 90% of the wealthy investors aren't going to pay that. So under the American Families Plan, the top capital gains tax would climb to 39.6%, up from 20% for Americans earning more than $1 million, like the fat man. So roughly $500,000.
Wait, is that mid-year earnings or full year earnings? Because right, you're a little light if that's full year earnings.
Yeah. Now, he plans to keep the existing Medicare surcharge in place, bringing federal tax rates all the way up to 43.4% for some Americans. And some Americans could pay as much as 60% in taxes. Think about that. What would you say, fat man, if I said, I'm going to give you a job, I'm going to pay you $100 an hour, but after taxes, you're only going to make $40 an hour?
Thanks, but no thanks.
Right. That's unacceptable. So out by you, I'm guessing, there was a new analysis done by Penn Wharton, a nonpartisan group over at the University of Pennsylvania's Wharton School. They suggested
I think that's where Trump went.
Well, they suggest that the rich Americans would employ techniques to avoid the rate increase. Tax avoidance, most of it legal, would cut $900 billion of the estimated $1 trillion. So he's counting on these higher earners to pay for $1.8 trillion, but this is already saying that's not going to happen because at least $900 billion of it, they're going to be able to sidestep. You know, and so capital gains doesn't affect everybody. For those that don't really understand capital gains, it's a government fee on profit made from selling certain types of assets. It could be stock investments or real estate. But it will affect you in some way, shape, or form. If you have a 401k, if you're selling houses off, I'm sure you're more vested in that area of taxes than I am. But
well, does that include if, like, just say hypothetically, somebody had a small island in the Caribbean that they owned, used occasionally for their vacations, and I mean, that person sold that island. Would I have to pay a capital gains tax on that?
I'm sure that if you went to the University of Pennsylvania's Wharton School, you could find a way around it.
So here's the thing, and this has been part of the liberal playbook for eons. That's one thing the liberals think they are, is they think they're the smartest people in the room, regardless of what the room is. They're not. They are surface thinkers. So when and one of the things that they try to sell to their base is punish successful people. And successful people, frankly, are not successful people. They ripped somebody else off, and that's how they became, that's how they got all that money. It had nothing to do with ability, knowledge, rising to the point of their you know, whatever their God-given abilities and work ethic was able to mine them, that's the reward that they got. They don't believe any of that. They feel that anyone who is successful did it by scamming the system, and the Democrats sell that. And that's exactly what this is. When you raise capital gains, the stock market takes a huge hit, and people, so many people in America are invested in the stock market. And there's a lot of people that have 401ks, Roth IRAs, all that type of stuff. And they don't necessarily equate that with being in the stock market. I mean, there's people that just, you know, they have somebody that tells them, give me this much money a month and I'll have some retirement set up. And they really don't understand it. That's the stock market, guys. That's the stock market. And if you go, when you start cashing that money in and you have to pay, not on the Roth, but when you start cashing that stuff in, you have to pay capital gains taxes on it. So this hurts everybody. And that's where the Democrats are great at. They make everything, I'm only going to penalize those people making $400,000. That's not me, right? Oh, yeah. It's in a shelter in China. Okay. And so they think they're only going to penalize certain people. And it's, again, this is one of my favorite sayings, as you know. Making a deal with the government is like making a deal with a crocodile to eat you last. Eat you last, he will, but he will eat you. And that's from Ronald Reagan. And that's what they're doing. When they say they're only going to tax XYZ, look, by taxing capital gains, it's not going to cover $6 trillion. It's not enough. They have to keep bringing those numbers down and bringing those numbers down. And Obama did this. He was only going to tax, I think it was $200,000. The next thing you know, you were being taxed at, if you made $92,000, which is a good living in most areas. You know, I couldn't get by on it, but in most areas, that's a good living. And all of a sudden now, you are being taxed. And, you know, one thing I think that's lost when we start talking about these big numbers that they're throwing around, because we can't grasp it. And look, I hope people understand that we're joking about, you know, income, and we say we own islands and, you know, all this kind of stuff, 92,000 is a bad sign. That's just joking around. I hope you guys get that. But people like us that get up in the morning and go and put on a hat and go to work, like my hat, by the way, for those watching the video.
I like it.
People like us who do that, we can't grasp what $47 million is. You can't grasp what $493 million is. You can't grasp what $10 billion is, what $20 billion is. If we can't grasp those kind of numbers, how can we register what $6 trillion actually is? You know how you can? And if you, again, you're looking on video, this is how you can do it. You take out one of these devices. It's called a calculator. $6 trillion, okay? $6 trillion. Let me just do a little quick math here. So if we take 6 trillion, 3 goes into the 600, that's a thousands, million, billion. I need one more zero. Okay, divided by carry the 7, add 26, tax it at 43%. Okay, so if you take $6 trillion, just to put this in perspective for you, how many million-dollar piles? If I told you, Justice, right now, I'll give you $1 million, what would you do? If I just said, look, tax-free, $1 million in your pocket, would you go to work tomorrow?
Yes.
I wouldn't. At your advanced age, you could retire. If you could retire... If
you didn't ask why I was going to work.
Oh,
I got the big FU letter in my pocket. Bam.
So we can agree that's awesome. We can agree that $1 million is a lot of money to average people like us.
Yes.
$6 trillion is $1 million. Let me add that again. Hundreds, thousands, yeah. So $6 trillion, which is what Biden has spent or is planning to spend in his first 3 or 4 months. 100 days is actually today. Day 100 is today. $6 trillion. That's 6 million piles of $1 million in cash.
I would like just one pile of it, please. Sir,
there's 6 million of them. Take one. Nobody's going to miss it. And how much of that goes on when you're spending $6 trillion? How much of that type of spending? I mean, we just have no grasp.
And you get a pile, and you get a pile, and you get a pile.
And she was only giving away Pontiac. What were they? Grand Ams or whatever they were. Yeah, those only things probably only cost 12 grand. And here's one other thing to put $6 trillion. And that's $6 trillion, by the way, Justice. That's in addition to the normal budget. Our budget is already in the trillions of dollars. Our normal budget. This is additional spending dollars. So $6 trillion. Just do you know what gross domestic product is? I'm sure you heard the phrase, but do you know what it is?
Enlighten me.
It's basically what you've generated. Like say you make $70,000 a year, and if you were a country. Your gross domestic product would be 70,000, and then so it's your gross, okay? So the gross domestic product of this country, we're the only one over $20 trillion, okay? So we generate $20 trillion in product and services out of this country. China's number two with $13 trillion. Okay. Now remember, he wants to spend $6 trillion. That's more than the gross domestic product of the entire country of Japan, the entire country of Germany, the entire country of the United Kingdom, Britain, and France. Then India, Italy, and Brazil. It's more than all three of those countries generate in a year. Three countries. And again, this is just a fraction of what he wants to spend. So basically what you're saying is there's no way we can generate enough income to cover spending $6 trillion. It can't pay for itself unless you raise taxes on a lot of people. You can't just raise it on the rich. And I wish I had the stat. I was looking for it and I couldn't find it. But a year or two ago, I heard this stat. You know, if you took the top 1%ers and you wiped out all of their assets, 100%, you taxed them on not only on their income, but you taxed everything they own, 100%. And you just, so basically, you made them all zero people. They have no cash, no assets, whatever. Took all of their money. It still wouldn't balance our budget, or still wouldn't balance everything we needed to do. So, and again, I wish I had the exact numbers because it was really powerful, but it was a couple years ago. But you can tax the top. It sounds great. It makes great headlines. You can tax, say you're going to tax the top people, only people making $400,000, only people are going to get harmed by the capital gains are going to be the people over $1 million a year. Oh yeah, screw that guy. But then what happens when that doesn't do anything? It goes from the deficit, which is your annual budget. More, anytime you spend more money than you had money coming in, that's your annual deficit. If you can't cover your bills in a year, it becomes debt. Our debt is around $30 trillion. And now we're going to add trillions on. And see, that's part of the problem here, Justice. I've been rattling off these numbers, and it's mind-numbing because we don't see it. Just like I said about 6 million piles of $1 million. Like, I can imagine 10 piles of $10. I can understand writing a check for $600. I can't grasp what $6 trillion is or what it even means. And that's what these Democrats and liberals are counting on, that we cannot follow the bouncing ball. It's too big for us to grasp and understand. We can't grasp spending $1 trillion. We can't grasp spending $1 billion. And Biden is just playing this country like a fiddle while he is being controlled by the puppet master.
Yeah. It's like a kid with a new credit card. Never had a credit card before. Mm-hmm. He doesn't understand it. He just kept
going on and on.
Hey, remember when we talked about the Oscars and you made fun of how low the ratings were?
Yes.
So let me put this into some perspective here. So last night, his address was watched by 11.6 million people, right? 11.6 million people. Our TikTok videos have had nearly 2 million views. So what does that say when we have one-fifth the watchers of somebody who watches the president on TV?
It's proof of our awesomeness. That's what I say.
Yeah, and Trump's his addresses to Congress averaged about 37.2 million. So nobody cares what he has to say. Nobody's buying it, except for the people that are already predisposed to buying it, and they're only buying it because it's everything in opposite land of Trump. That's the only reason. That's all they cared about why Trump was in office. That's all they care about now. Biden is doing exactly opposite, so yay, it's a great freaking deal. And
here comes
I
the free stuff.
I get more frustrated with it every day. There's days at a time where I can't even watch the news because it, like you said, it's mind-numbing to me.
Well, here's one other thing, and this is where I'm going to see this maybe a little bit differently than you do, which I think is good. You know, I know in this country we're not allowed to think differently. Everybody has to have one think. But I see this a little bit differently. And this is something that I think, this is where we can have a discussion. I think Republicans and Democrats can if they were able to operate, like they used to 20 or 25, 30 years ago, where you got in a room and you negotiated and you made your case and you came to some compromise and you moved things forward. I think items like preschool, I think items like free community college and free trade schools, I think that's a conversation that needs to be had. And here's why. It's not just an effort to give people free stuff. Education and knowledge, and that can either be knowledge from a book, knowledge from a professor, or knowledge from a master carpenter who's teaching you how to build a house. Okay, so those are the type of things. Knowledge and education is still king, regardless of what type of knowledge or education you acquire. That's the kind of stuff that pulls people out of poverty. And that's why I think we can have that conversation. And Biden, I think, actually said it last night, and he's right on this one, that kids who get a start in pre-K, in a good solid pre-K, before they go to kindergarten, are much more likely to succeed. So that money, to me, is an investment in our future. Okay.
But don't we already have the Head Start program?
Yeah, you have some of it, but I think it needs to be – we're seeing enough data that shows it needs to be better. And keep in mind, they probably had this, I don't know, whenever they started, you know, free education hundreds of years ago or whatever, you know, for grade school and high school. They probably had similar concerns about it then, you know, at what point do we stop? But this isn't send your kid to Yale and we'll pay for it. Send your kid to Case Western Reserve and we'll pay for it. Send them to the University of Florida and we'll pay for it. This is, you know, 2 year because here's the thing that also does this about the community college aspect of it. If you can help people get that 2 year community college degree, that is not just the 2 year degree that they get, they also have the opportunity to turn that into a 4 year degree for about half the cost.
Let me ask you this.
Yeah, go ahead.
How does it affect, like, my kid? He can actually graduate high school with an associate's degree because he's in advanced classes while we're still allowed to have them. He could take college credit classes his last 2 years of high school and actually graduate high school with an associate's degree. So what happens then?
I don't know. I don't know. And here's the thing. There's going to be finite details, and that would be a perfect example of one that has to be figured out. But that's why you have the Department of Education. That's why you have, you know, universities and, you know, these people that know these types of things. That's above my pay grade. But I'm telling you, programs like that are an investment in our future, and it's going to help kids who don't have the opportunity, maybe like your son has. And I just think that that's something where we invest that money in and we get a return out of it. I'm not big on free stuff. I don't want checks being written to, you know, somebody goes to Ohio State and, you know, their parents make $250,000 a year and they get a government check for $50,000 paying off their student debt. I don't want to see that. You know, if you go to, you know, like we have Duquesne here in Western Pennsylvania, it's a very expensive private school. If you go there and you can't afford to pay for it and you come out of there with $150,000 in debt, so sorry. You made the choice. You made the decision. Your parents helped you make that decision. Now pay for it. I'm talking about, you know, giving people the opportunity to lift themselves up. And it's not going to cure everybody. And I guess we'd have to see longer range stats, but that's a conversation that I think needs to be had in giving people better exposure to education. You know, school choice, which is something Republicans have pushed for a long time. And you want to talk about something that'll bring down these crime rates and help close the gap between, you know, blue and black. Having people making higher incomes and have something to lose makes them better people, makes them contribute more to society. Because if you have nothing to lose, then you're willing to take these risks with guns and dealing drugs and stealing. If you have something to lose, a good job, a solid home in a solid neighborhood, you know, doesn't mean you're in the most expensive neighborhood in the most expensive house, but a good solid, you know, middle-class living. We need to expose more people to that opportunity. And I think education is the way to do it. And if you remember a few weeks ago, I know I'm babbling here a lot, but I'll let you get in here. But remember a few weeks ago, I said, I brought up there were three things you could do to give you like a 78% chance of succeeding. One was don't get pregnant or married before the age of 21, graduate high school, get a job. You know, and that gave you like a 78% chance of being in the middle class or higher. And that's not rocket science. And I think something like this, the education aspect of it, I think it's a springboard to do that. It's just my opinion. I'm certainly open to other sides of that. But I just think if we're going to start throwing dollars at something, let's throw something dollars at something that gives us a return. And that's getting people educated and letting them work their way to better lives and being better taxpayers.
Yeah, it's a good idea in theory. But before we get to the secondary education, we've got to get people to go to school. Mm-hmm. And in some of these inner city and urban schools, we have to get them to graduate school, to high school, before we can even worry about moving on. We solve that problem, that too would help. And I don't have the answer to that, but I believe that would be a big step in the right direction.
Well, I'll tell you when, and you can make your own conclusion, but when this all started to go bad, especially in the inner cities and minority communities, is when Democrats gave incentives to dismantle the nuclear family. Back in the 60s, and this is, it's an exact opposite statistic right now. Back in the 60s, and I think, and I don't have it in front of me, but it's something like 75 or 80% of African-American families in the 60s, there was a father in the home, two-parent home. Okay. That number has gone the absolute opposite direction now. So now you have about 24% have what's referred to as the nuclear family, two parents. And
yeah, I would say probably 60, 70% of my kids' friends are living with both parents.
Yeah.
Like straight up parents, not like, some of them have stepdads, stepmoms, sure. They've been remarried. But I mean natural from birth parents, I'd say maybe only 60, 70%. Hey folks, stick around. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
You are listening to The Halls of Justice. If you would like to be a guest, have a comment, or a show idea, then send us an email at justice@hallsofjustice.com. Halls of Justice is a weekly podcast, and you can always find our latest episodes listed on our webpage at www.hallsofjustice.com.
on Facebook, Twitter, and TikTok.
Help us grow and spread the word.
Please share with your friends.
Now back to more exciting entertainment on the Halls of Justice.
I'm a real American. Fight for the rights of every man. Mm-hmm. I am a real American.
Fight for the right.
What's right. Fight for your life.
Welcome back to the Halls of Justice. Part two. Usually you only get one episode a week, but this time you are so lucky that you get to share two nights with us.
Are you
not one, but two? Don't forget, sign up for our email program. Let you know when the new podcast comes out. All you got to go to our website, www.hallsofjustice.com. There's a subscribe button right at the top. Click that. Just enter your email. You don't even got to enter in your name. Nothing, because we don't care. We just want you to get the information we're putting out. We're not going to sell your email, and you only get an email when we drop a new show, like once a week, sometimes twice if you're lucky. But be sure you get that done. The smartest people in the world, my friend. Remember when Biden said that Hunter was the smartest person he's ever met?
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure Camel Toe is the smartest person I've ever met. Because she was giving a speech in Baltimore, and she says this. I can't do a voice. I am proud to report that we've provided relief to 4 million small businesses in our country. In 100 days, we have created more new jobs than any other administration in history. So, I'm missing out on where these jobs are and how they've done it in 100 days. They've created more jobs than any other administration in history. Did you hear the speech? Have you heard the quote?
I that's the first I've heard the quote. I did hear some of her speech. And honestly, because I had a feeling you were going to bring this up, I removed all sharp and heavy objects from within 3 yards of me, so I can't reach. Because right now, I have such a desire to just take a claw hammer and start smashing myself in the head. because people fall for this BS. She's, oh boy. Okay. So when are we going to understand that President Harris is just in over her head? All she does is cackle. And you know, that's a defense mechanism. Talk to anybody who has knowledge in psychology or psychiatry. When you do something like that, even people in broadcasting know it's a common ploy. When you get asked something, it buys you some time. And if you've ever, obviously you and I spent time in radio, a few seconds can make all the difference when you're trying to form a thought. So just like when she was asked, well, when are you going to go to the border? not today. All that time, we think she's laughing. That is not what she's doing. She's buying herself some time to try and come up with something that actually makes some sense. Okay, she is in over her head. You want to talk about Sleepy Joe? This woman is so far in over her head. She has no idea what she's doing. Her boss, the President of the United States, told her to go down and take care of the border. You're now going to be in charge of that.
He said go down.
It's not the first time she's heard that. It told her to go down to the border and fix the problem. Anybody that had abilities or had a desire to be a success based on merit and not on who they slept with would take that opportunity and go, oh my God. The President of the United States put me in charge of the southern border. This is a golden opportunity for me to show how great I am. I don't care what you do for a living. If your boss comes up and challenges you with a task, you either shrink from it because you're weak and incompetent, or you rise to the occasion and you soar. And what she has done so far is shrunk in the corner and went and hidden from the problem. Now, as far as creating these jobs, what she is saying makes absolutely no sense. This is another case, just like with the COVID, all they had to do is get out of the way and let the economy do what it is going to do. The economy was already greased and ready to go. You had one of the biggest industries in this country, the restaurant industry, sitting on the freaking sidelines. All you had to do was unleash it and let it go. And it was going to come back. The economy was already booming. You're paying $40 for a sheet of $8 plywood because they can't produce it fast enough for all the building and remodeling that's going on. The economy was coming back without them being involved. All they had to do was get out of the damn way. And why not just do that? Just get out of the way and let it happen. No, just like,
I invented COVID, and I fixed everything.
And he comes out and takes credit for curing COVID. Now she comes out and gives President Harris and President Biden credit for bringing all these jobs back. She's full of crap. She's incompetent. She's in over her head, and everybody's afraid to say it because she's the first person of color and the first woman to be the vice president, and nobody has the balls to challenge her on anything.
Agreed. And
all that, and that's what I hear. That's the...
Well, and we were having a technical issue. While
I heard that echo. Did you fix it?
I think so.
I hope you didn't ruin my speech, because if you did, I quit.
He's out. Just take it out of my pay. I think it's fixed. We started getting, I don't know if people heard it at home. We started getting some feedback.
Yeah, there was an echo.
So I actually switched your channel while you were talking, and I think we're all good now. So
yeah,
I don't hear it anymore.
Well, I hope you just didn't ruin my wonderful rant.
It wasn't that bad to begin with. So the gist of your rant is still there. We're good.
Okay.
Love you, baby.
Are you going to do something else to rile my blood pressure off? Okay. Well, let's move to this one. As we get into this little bit of a, well, that makes sense. Because what you just said about Kamala, well, that makes sense. Here's one about Trump. Well, that makes sense. follow me on this one. Trump gets absolutely no credit for the vaccine and Operation Warp Speed and the development of the vaccine. Gets no credit for its rollout and guiding the country through COVID. Okay, Fair enough. Everybody hated Trump. We knew he was just bloviated and he was full of himself, blah, blah, blah. But Trump gets absolutely no credit. Even if he didn't do anything, he was still president. So wouldn't you kind of give him credit for something? No, no credit. He gets no credit. Ask anybody on the left. He did absolutely nothing. Matter of fact, he killed people during COVID. He literally, I'm not saying he put them in nursing homes like Cuomo did. He literally, if you ask somebody on the left, Trump literally went to people's houses and just killed people. Okay. But he gets no credit for any of the development and rollout of COVID vaccine. On the other side, Biden gets all the credit for the vaccine, and all you have to do is watch any of the news medias. Just pick any one of them out. He gets all the credit for a vaccine that was literally developed and put in his arm. He was injected with the vaccine. Kakala was just injected. And and he had it before he went into office. So this vaccine was already there. So, but, and it was already there. The plan was already there before he took office. But Biden gets all the credit for bringing us out of COVID-19. Trump literally did it. Biden didn't do it. Trump gets no credit. Biden gets all the credit. Help me understand this, Justice.
Well, all you got to do is say it enough, and people start believing you. So all he had to do was say, it was all me. We didn't remember what he said? They didn't even have the vaccine before he got there?
But yes.
He was injected with the vaccine.
Our cupboards were bare. Our cupboards were bare. The cupboards were bare.
That's... What did they say? If you tell a big lie long enough, enough people will believe it.
It becomes the truth, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that. Well, that makes sense. I've got another one that makes sense.
No, you don't.
That might be another Joe Whopper. It might be another lie. Okay, so do Black Lives Matter? And I'm going to tell you right up front. This is another one you're probably not going to like me on. I'm okay with Black Lives Matter. I'm okay with the sentiment. I'm okay with the grassroots people in neighborhoods saying Black Lives Matter. Because what they're saying, Justice, is we just want you guys to understand that we feel our lives don't matter, and we want you to know that we do. We want that respect of you understanding that our lives matter. Now, Black Lives Matter, the organization, totally different scenario. But I think, like I told you yesterday when we closed the show, we have to talk about being able to understand other people's perspective, even if we don't agree with it, okay? And that's kind of what I'm saying here. We got to understand the grassroots meaning of the phrase Black Lives Matter and keep it separate from the organization. But where I'm going with this, and I just wanted to clarify what I meant about, you know, Black Lives Matter, and that I understand the sentiment. But the real question is, do all lives matter? And that's a saying that kind of, you know, people shouted back at Black Lives Matter. No, it's not Black Lives Matter. All lives matter. You know what? In fact, both of those phrases are correct. Black lives do matter. All lives do matter. They don't have to be mutually exclusive. They just apply. Now, where am I going with all this?
Good question.
Black lives matter. All lives matter. The big million-dollar question, do all Black lives matter? So we've talked numerous times about it seems only certain Black lives matter to race baiters like Crump, Jesse Jackson, Sharpton, AOC, Ilhan Omar. Only the ones that fit the narrative that they needed to, those are the Black lives that matter. Every single one of them's tragic. When somebody young and dies unnecessarily, it's tragic. Whether it's the hands of a police officer, whether it's the hands of another person. However, it's just, it's tragic on every level when we lose a life that we shouldn't have. But yes, why?
Because
I'm almost there. Why don't we care when a 7-year-old is shot at a McDonald's drive-thru? Why don't we care when 31 people are shot in a weekend in our biggest city, New York City? Why don't we care when we're setting shooting and murder records in Seattle, in Minneapolis, in Chicago, in New York City, in San Francisco? Why don't we care about all black lives, not just the ones that get you the headlines and put money in your pocket? And I'm talking to you, Ben Crump.
Well, I think most Americans care about all black lives. But as you said, I also agree that unless it fits the narrative, unless it advances the cause, unless it creates publicity and also creates hate, then it doesn't qualify for them as being newsworthy, as being something they want to promote.
And why? And I bet you already know the answer, but why? Because it's bad for business.
Yes.
When people of all races and Americans get along, it's bad for business. And if you can stir the pot, forget that they're ignoring how many, you know, there's 10 people dying over here and 1,000 dying over here, and they're worrying about the 10 more than the 1,000. First of all, you should worry about all of them. You should worry if there's a 10 over here and 1,000 over here, that's 1,010 people that you should be worried about. But no, yeah, they only worry about the 10 because that's at the hands of a police officer.
Well, I do got to give Tim Scott credit. Did you listen to his rebuttal to the speech?
I want to officially announce my love for Tim Scott, and I'm not sure if South Carolina has passed a law on gay marriage, but I'm planning on looking into it and seeing if he will marry me.
Yes, very well-spoken man with a lot of great ideas. And he came out and, you know, he said that America is not racist. And he started going down the line. And, of course, he was attacked mercilessly on the social medias. But, yeah, if you have not listened to him talk and have not listened to his rebuttal, you need to Google him, use the Google machine, and look him up for certain.
If you didn't listen to that speech, you missed something. And even all the pundits were saying how great of a job. And even the Democrat idiots, the pundits on CNN and MSNBC, it looked like they were trying to pass kidney stones. But it wasn't. Tim Scott was okay. It pained them so much to admit that Tim Scott was okay. But they had here, and I did go to social media to see. That's why I a few minutes ago I asked you if you're an uncle. Well, apparently now Tim Scott is Uncle Tim. Scott Nevin said Senator Tim Scott is Uncle Tomming it for his life. So sad. South Carolina should be so ashamed. A white guy just called a sitting U.S. senator who's African-American an Uncle Tom. But that's okay. Another person, Ricky Davila. I just turned off the Tim Scott Uncle Tom GQB rebuttal. I don't need their token sharing their propaganda in my home after hearing an exceptional speech and plans for the future. And apparently this guy is a religious man because he said, "Not today, Satan." Mr. Vegas says, while saying this, Uncle Tim, and Uncle is capitalized, Tim Scott said America is not a racist society. Charmaine says, Tim Scott does not represent black people. He knows he is not liked, admired, or respected in the greater black community. Why
but
not?
Why? Yeah, why?
Why not?
Your line is question everything. Why? Why is he not respected? My question is, who gets top billing, DeSantis or Scott?
DeSantis
on the ticket.
And I'll tell you why. Not because I'm a racist, because I, you know, of course, that's going to be the first reaction. Well, you know, he's a racist because he wants the white guy at the top of the ticket. That's exactly the ticket I would love to see right now. And that could change as we go along. But right now, what DeSantis is doing in Florida, for one thing, Tim Scott has said in interviews that he's not ready to be president. So right now, that'll be a line that'll come back to haunt him a little bit, that he's not ready to be president. And maybe he's just being honest, which is refreshing in itself. But I think he would do better to be in the vice president position, because remember, DeSantis is the lead executive of Florida, which has a direct parallel to being the lead executive of the country. So I think just in natural play, DeSantis top of the ticket, Tim Scott in the second position. But the Republican field is going to be absolutely loaded. And I don't mean like when Trump won the primary in 16, where it was a case of there were a lot of people but not a lot of great candidates. I think unless Trump comes out and says he's going to take the nomination, because I don't think he'll get very many challengers. But that aside, there are going to be a lot of great choices. It's really going to be hard to narrow down who the Republican nominee is going to be. But certainly DeSantis has put a stamp on it. And I think Tim Scott did himself took a pretty big step forward to putting his name on the vice presidential position.
Yeah. Yeah. Does DeSantis run against Trump, or at the end of the day, is it going to be one of those, is Trump would probably get the nod, bring him on as the VP?
And that would be the big question for DeSantis. Would that be a parallel step for him to go from being the governor of Florida to being the vice president? Now, the one interesting twist there, Trump would only be able to run for one term. So you wouldn't be waiting 8 years for your shot to be the president. It would only be 4 years. So I think right now, with the support that Trump has, that Trump base, and maybe out of the 75 million, I'm talking about 35 or 40 million of it. Like Trump said famously one time that he could, and he said it jokingly. Of course, the Democrats can't understand anything jokingly. He said something to the effect that he could go right out to Times Square and shoot somebody and they would still love him. And you've got a base of people, and I'm certainly a Trump supporter, but you have a base of probably 30, 35, 40 million people that are just going to, if Trump runs, they're going to support him. And that kind of support out of the gate is going to be really hard for somebody else to come and overtake him. So if Trump decides to run, I just can't imagine a scenario. And I'm not sure that's going to be the best thing for the party, because I'm not sure he can win in a general.
That's my only thought is, you know, I support him, but I'm kind of torn because, like you said, there's some young up-and-comers deserve the nod. So at the end of the day, the question is, who is electable? Is Trump electable? Is DeSantis electable? Which one has the better chance? Because I can't do 4 more years of this. I can't.
Well, the good news is we may only have to do another year and a half of this, because the midterms are coming, and I think it's going to be a steamroll. I don't think a red wave even approaches what we're going to see in 2022, because I believe we are a center-right country.
And you know what's going to happen then? There's going to be a war. There's going to be another pandemic. There's going to be something to distract from it.
That's my
tin hat theory.
Fauci's already working on COVID-20.
Yeah.
But, you know, going back to your question, I don't think Trump's going to run. I'll tell you that right now. I don't think he's going to. I think he's going to take the role as kingmaker, and you know he's going to be the leader of the party until the new president takes over. And I think he's just going to relish that role. And I think that's the way he's going to go. That's just my gut feeling on it. And I would say, I mean, you got the the governor of South Dakota. Is it Gnomes? Christie? I forget her last name. Anyway, she's a strong candidate. There's just, I think right now, if you gave me about 5 minutes, I could come up with 10 to 12 strong Republican candidates. And I think it's hard to imagine anybody being higher on that list than DeSantis. And not just because of what he's doing in Florida, but also he's the Trump that a lot of us wanted. That person that would smack somebody down if it was appropriate.
Politely,
but wasn't always in smackdown mode. Like when Trump would tweet something, he's like, oh, President, Mr. President, why did you do that? Because I wanted him to get elected again, and I knew he was doing stuff that was going to turn off some of those middle-of-the-road voters, you know? And DeSantis isn't like that. He will layeth the smacketh down when he needs to, but he also will do it in a more professional way. So I just think he's a slicker version. I don't mean that as an insult in any way. Just a slicker, more polished version of Donald Trump.
Well, we better hope he doesn't have any skeletons in the closet, because you know they're going to be looking for him.
They'll make him up. It's going to be he went to Iceland and got urinated on by hookers.
Yeah. So we're almost to the end of the show.
That's amazing.
I know, right? Here's something for you, since we usually do some lighthearted stuff here towards the end.
Yeah.
It's a flashback, taking us back. Kakala Harris said she would support less. She would support eating less meat if elected president. eating less meat.
We're racing to punchlines. We're stepping on each other trying to get the punchlines. If she would have followed that rule her whole entire life, she never would have been Attorney General of California.
What you got?
I thought you had something there.
No, that was my funny punchline.
Hey, I just want to offer condolences, and I know we have a very, very high listenership in the Cleveland metropolitan area, northwest and northeast Ohio, northern half of Ohio, and I just, as sincere as I can be, I just want to offer the condolences to whomever the Browns draft in the first round. I'm just terribly sorry. Young man works that hard and has to go play for the Browns. I feel terrible about that.
This is not the same old Browns.
That's what they
I'm
all
say.
I'm
not saying it's much better, but it's not the same.
You will be the Browns until you're not. And right now, you still are. One actually sincere well wishes I do want to offer. You know who Dan Crenshaw is, right?
I think you're still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay. You dropped out for a second.
No, sorry. You know who Dan Crenshaw is, right?
Yes.
Rep from, he's, for those of you who don't know, he's representative, congressman from Texas. And he was also, I think he was a SEAL. He was in Special Forces, and I don't want to say the wrong one. He'll track me down. But he was, I think he was a SEAL, and he lost his eye in Afghanistan, but ended up, he still has one good eye. Over the last few weeks, he's kind of and he is tremendous. Again, another rising Republican star. I mean, he is tremendous with his, and I'm not, it's just like what Tim Scott did the other night. He's very on point. He's very factual. He doesn't look to get down in the mud with anybody, and I think he's great, and I think he's going to be a tremendous leader going forward and a real star in the Republican Party. But he, as I mentioned, he lost one of his eyes in battle, and he was having problems with his retina in his one remaining eye, and it was very touch and go, and it's still a little bit iffy, but it was, you know, very touch and go as to whether he was going to lose sight in that second or his one remaining eye, and he had to have a procedure, and I guess they were able to reattach the retina, and so far things are going the right direction. But you know, all That's the well news. Wishes for Dan Crenshaw, because he is a great human and he's a great American.
Yeah, and I sent out a few feelers to Max Miller. He's a Republican candidate for Congress in Ohio's 16th district. He's going to be going up against Anthony Gonzalez, who has turned out to be more of a Democrat than a Republican. So we've sent out some messages. I know he's developing a big following on the Twitters and in Northern Ohio. if anybody has any contacts before his reps read this, maybe you can get it into their hands and let us know. Try to get him on the show. We'll see what we can do.
Alrighty, Fat Man. That's going to do it for this week. It's just like that. We did 2 hours in 2 days, and it just, where did the time go? I ask you this every week. Where did the time go?
This was a supplemental edition of the Halls of Justice, and you're welcome. You're welcome, America.
You're welcome. Alrighty, folks, be sure you sign up for our emails. Be sure you share our stuff, okay? We need to get this shared. We need to get it out there. We have to pass 11.8 million listeners. We're almost there.
I want a recount on Joe's 11.8 million. Didn't a bunch of those listeners show up last minute in, like, Philadelphia? I think he was he was pacing like 1 million, and all of a sudden at 3 in the morning, he got like 11 million viewers.
There it was. I'm sure Kakala is counting the hanging chads.
The Halls of Justice. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe.
If you have a show idea,
would like to be a guest, or just want to communicate with the show, email us at hallsofjustice@roadrunner.com. You can also find us on Facebook.
Tell all your friends.
And we'll see you for a new episode next week of the Halls of Justice.